Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us. My name is Jeffrey Fowler. I'm a personal technology columnist with the Wall Street Journal. Mm-hmm. And I am super excited today to be joined by Cynthia Brazil. She is an MIT professor and expert in social robotics and the creator of this little guy named Jibo.
Yes.
Thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
What or who is Jibo?
So Jibo is the world's first family robot.
A family robot.
A family robot is for the family. And it's a platform. So it's bringing the magic of social robotics to all kinds of apps and services so third-party developers can create new skills for Jibo. So now we have a robot that can actually do many things for all members of the family.
Can you show us a little bit of what he can do?
Yeah, so we can have Jibo just give a little intro.
Yeah, let's meet him.
Yeah, so Jibo, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Jibo. I am the world's first family robot. I'm excited to show you some skills I've been working on. I'm hoping to be part of my very own family someday soon. I can recognize you, listen to you, and interact with you like a hands-free helper. And as we learn about each other, I can help you and fit into your life even better. First of all, I love to express myself. Check out my moves. Slow down, and you move too fast.
Tell me about how Jibo then came to be. So you guys announced that you had a prototype idea for Jibo in the summer, and you you went online to raise some money.
That's right.
And you were going to raise $100,000.
That's right.
And then what happened?
And then we actually raised 2.3. So it was a
$2.3 million.
Yeah, phenomenal success for
us. So people are kind of into the idea of a social robot.
I think they're ready.
I mean, obviously, folks have been thinking about the idea and comfortable with the idea of, or just fascinated by the idea of a social robot since at least Star Wars, since at least C-3PO.
Before that, yeah.
And before that as well. What has changed that makes it now possible for something like Jibo to exist?
I mean, a lot has changed. I think, you know, the mobile computing revolution, I think, had to happen first. You know, building a robot like Jibo takes a lot of different kinds of components. Mm-hmm. And because mobile phones and things like that are so ubiquitous, the price and performance curves have just all gone in the right direction. So now the exciting thing is it's possible to build a sophisticated social robot at a mass consumer price point, and that's very recent.
So what makes them a social robot as opposed to like a Roomba, which is a very practical robot?
Yeah, so you know, so much of my work has shown that a lot of the field has assumed that robotics, the main value proposition was about physical work, you know, doing some of physical work. And what I've discovered through creating these social robots is it's a profoundly engaging medium for human interaction. So when you think about our world of these flat screens, Jibo is a technology that brings all of that content to life in the physical world in a whole new way. And when you make that mind shift of robot from physical labor to robot for content, now for the first time you can have a robot that can actually do many things for you, right? So a robot that can help teach your kids a second language, or a robot that can help you stay in a diet and exercise program, or a robot that can help you cook, or a robot that can do telepresence, right? So now suddenly you have this three-dimensional, more socially community-present device versus the screen that you pick up and you poke at in your home that can do many, many things for you.
How do you make a robot seem human? Can you break down some of the elements of the design and the interaction with Jibo that you think take it to the human level?
Yeah, so I always distinguish humanized versus human because I mean, you can tell, I mean, it's an abstract anthropomorphic form, and that's on purpose because we want it to be able to bring all kinds of content to life. Uh-huh. Once you start putting too many humanoid features, you actually start to box it in. Huh. So it's humanized, which means it's familiar, but it's also, it's distinct in its own way. So when you think about how do you make something humanized, there's many, many different layers of it. So there's the engagement, the mechanics of the interaction, which is the voice, what you say, but it's also how it moves and responds. So it's how it perceives your social cues and how it responds. And we know a lot from human social psychology. This is where this engagement and the sense of reciprocity comes in. So you feel like you're actually talking to someone than a something. So that's like the beginning of it.
So when you talk to him, it responds immediately.
It responds, exactly. It's like it looks at you, it responds. You feel like you're actually talking to someone, right? And then there's the aspect of it getting to know you, right? Getting to learn about you, being able to recognize you by face, by voice, you know, your preferences, how you engage with it, right? So that's making it more personal. And then you start layering on, again, the content and the skills, and then it becomes collaborative.
Then you tell people, oh, there's going to be a robot that's going to live in your house, and you get all these utopian ideas, like, wow, think of all the things it's going to do for me. And we even get that in other kind of artificial intelligence kinds of things that exist today. But then we know that there's this gulf, right, between what you imagine a robot might do for you and what it can actually do for you in 2015.
Sure.
What can a robot actually do for you in 2015, and what can it not do?
So, I mean, I think, you know, in the near term, I mean, if there's a big vision, but in the near term, I think what we found is that, and this is how we've positioned Jibo, the more that you're clear about these are the skills that Jibo helps you with, Jibo is not like this open-ended, just say anything, it's going to help you do anything. Jibo is really about there's specific kinds of things it can help you with. And with those things, it's going to have competence within those domains. I think when you design a device, when you design a technology like that, you're much more able to deliver on the promise of what it's supposed to do. I think the challenge happens is when you don't know where those boundaries are, and then you start hitting up the edges where it wasn't designed to support it, when you don't have the right expectations of how it can help you. So Jibo, when you talk about the skills, that's actually a very important framing. And you know what skills you can download to the robot, and then you know how it's going to be able to help you. So, you know, there is an important sense of how you help communicate to people. Here's the things that Jibo can do for you out of the box. These are the things that you can add to Jibo through the ecosystem. And the great thing is because it's a platform, those things will continue to grow and expand and improve over time.
In the other sort of voice-activated technologies in our lives today, you see different theories, right? Mm-hmm. So let's just take an Android phone versus iPhone. Mm-hmm. iPhone, Siri, you talk to her, but she seems to have a personality. She'll tell you a joke. Mm-hmm. You know, she'll you know, you ask her to set a timer, and she says at the end, "I can't wait." Now, yeah. Google, with their voice-activated system, it doesn't really have a sense of humor, and it seems intentional. Who has it right?
You know, I think it just depends on what kind of technology and experience you're really trying to create. You know, I distinguish a relational social agent like Jibo, which is more like combining a full-fledged character with utility than something that's a pure information agent, right? So Jibo's a relational agent. It's meant to be designed to be more like this collaborative partner versus something that you ask questions of and it answers you. Those are very different kinds of agents when you think about it. And Jibo is really being designed to be much more of this, plays a role for you as a collaborator, helps support you, right? So that's our design intent. And we want it to fit into the home in a way that, again, adds this warmth and this experience of home. So the personality of Jibo, you know, the fact that it's fun, you know, that it can be a little, you know, cheeky, I think is an important part of the experience that we want to bring to the Jibo world, you know, which is different than if you really want an information agent, per se. So, I mean, it's really just what your design intent is.
So as we wrap up here, what's next for Jibo? So this is a prototype.
Yes.
When is Jibo going to be ready for the world, and how are folks going to get them?
Yeah, so it's going to happen in stages. So through our crowdfunding campaign, we pre-sold almost 5,000 units.
And how much does it cost?
So the full retail price will be $599, price of an iPad. And we're going to start shipping the developer units first for obvious reasons, because when we do the mass launch in 2016, we want to have stuff in the ecosystem as well. But we'll start shipping right now for the developer units late this year, moving into 2016, and then the plan is in mid-2016 will be more of the general availability. But we'll start with those crowdfunding units first.
Got it.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for joining us and bringing your old friend.
Great.
Take care.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Great.
Okay.